Well, I had a slight mishap with the cliff on the way back here. Our last pile of souls is gone. But 15,000's good enough, and our main goal here isn't so much to leave with a bazillion souls, because we already did that in the pure Black World Tendency mode, as it is to just finish this segment. So last time we fell victim to the Shadow Lurker. This time I'm going to be extra cautious. Extra cautious. But first, we have to get by these guys. So, unlike last time, I'm wearing the Ring of Magical Dullness right now. And that is going to let me tank hits a little better from that magic. I should be able to survive one hit, which will let me survive long enough to get close enough to the Shadow Man that his AI will tell him that it's time to attack me physically. And you can also see that if you can get down onto the same level as the Shadow Man, you can duck under the laser. It's very helpful. Can't duck under hugs, though. You have to avoid those by backstepping. Alright. So first, I'm just going to comb the area a little. See, the weird thing about the Lurker is that it doesn't spawn until you've gone, past a certain distance. And even then, it doesn't spawn with any sort of fanfare, like these guys just do. It just kind of, exists. It's also not connected to the Reapers, as far as I know. So the guy's still gonna spawn, even if I killed the Reaper first. There he is. Notice how he just kind of appeared out of nowhere. But without the element of surprise, these guys are pretty easy. Now then, on to the Reaper. You might have seen him last time, but when I was playing, I didn't. A little too much darkness. But before we go after him, we'll take out this one last Shadow Man, because I would really hate to take a shadowy fist to the back of the head while I'm burning a Reaper alive. Or dead. I'm really not certain how that works. Anyways, Reaper's here. I am really happy that I have the Ring of Dullness on, because otherwise that would have been deadly. And another good thing is that the Reaper isn't going to chase me out here. He's going to stick where he is. Unlike the Necromancers in Dark Souls that will readily join the fray and come after you a bit, this guy's just going to stay put. And be very difficult to lock onto, apparently. Alright. That does it for him. But I think his body is going to meet with a bit of an accident. He's such an asshole. Whoops! Can't imagine how that happened. Better notify your next of kin. Anyways, onward! That's about it for the staircases. Really, I think that's the most dangerous part of the level, just because there's tiny walkways and sweeping death lasers. Oh, and this is a trap if you've ever seen one. I mean, come on. Really? Where's the Shadow Lurker? Maybe I actually have to pick up the treasure first. Oh, nope, there we go. And not one, but two. That could actually cause a bit of a problem if they can get through my shield stability. But they can't. Of course, the entire thing was apparently an even bigger trap than expected, because that treasure was not worth fighting two Shadow Lurkers. Alright, back outside, it's a good thing that I still have the Thieves' Ring equipped, because storm beasts are just the last thing I want to deal with right now. Even with it, as you can see, sometimes they get close enough to see you. Alright, back inside, we've got another round of Shadow Man Madness to go. This time, the challenge is Claustrophobia. Flame Toss is extremely powerful against these guys, but because of the cramped quarters and the strange geometry of these walls, there's also a good chance that it's just going to get just clip off a tiny little bit of geometry and explode prematurely, which leaves you open to get killed. Of course, since there's a Reaper around here and he's a total asshole, you can also spawn Shadow Man right behind you. It's very reminiscent of the one segment in Tomb of the Giants where the Bone Tower appears behind you and sneaks up. Anyways, this guy's gonna fire lasers, and he's also stronger than basically every other Shadow Man so far. Oh, and that guy was hiding just off-screen. In fact, this exact enemy placement was used in Tomb of the Giants. But he would have been easily dealt with, but Flame Toss clipped off a wall and I died. That sucks. That's a death that you wish you could have back. But it was uneventful getting back here, and instead of dealing with Flame Toss, let's just make this guy bleed. Turns out Reapers do have blood in their system, and also have their own issues with geometry. I guess that's poetic justice. You make my Flame Toss clip into a wall, I make your corpse fling itself throughout existence. Clip through all the walls. Alright, so that's the second segment. First was the initial tomb with the first Reaper. Second was descending down those staircases. And the final segment of the level is this. The underground caves. This segment is very obnoxious. Those white orbs flying around are bombs. They're like the skulls in the catacombs and Tomb of the Giants. They're purely physical damage, so once they finish eating all my stamina, there's still enough damage to nearly kill me. They are triggered by too much movement or sound within their vicinity, but they don't really have a chasing algorithm, they just kind of float around. Alright. These guys I recall being a lot more weak to fire than they were, but it could just be that the Ring of Magical Dullness lowers fire damage, even though it's not actual magic damage. I thought I was going to be clever there, but apparently I misunderstood the game mechanics again. Maybe. The ring might just be weird. It's one of the problems sometimes, is it's a little difficult to figure out exactly how your weapon or armor works without having somebody who's, extensively studied it and put it all up on a Wikipedia page somewhere. That's one thing that I just didn't want to do in this run-through, is constantly consult Wikipedia to decide what to do next. And, well, it's more fun that way. But I do miss things, and sometimes just have no clue how my own shit works. In any case, these are the same sort of slugs that we're going to see in the Valley of Defilement as well when we come back there. They drop sticky white stuff, which can enchant a non-enchanted weapon, giving it magic damage. When you enchant something, it doesn't replace the regular damage type with a different damage type, it just adds additional damage onto it. So enchantments and things like Turpentine are actually extremely powerful. I use them extensively with my melee characters that I play through the game with. Not so much necessary now because I've got a magic sword and I've been pumping my magic stat quite a bit. Whoa. Okay, ragdolls. Okay. Quite a few slugs here. Now, the attack I'm using is actually the R2 strong attack. The regular attack for the curved sword isn't going to reach these guys. You gotta do the R2 strong attack, which is, I mean, it's good because it kills them faster, and also it's the only thing that hits them. Ah, and as you saw right there, the other thing these guys drop is sucker stones. I remembered what those did between videos. That gives your weapon the tearing quality, and the tearing quality makes things cause bleeding, which is nowhere near as good as it was in Dark Souls. It's just another type of poison. Okay, cute. Lovely. You also notice at this point that my health bar is back up to full. Between takes, I revived myself to human and got back online. Since this stage in particular is kind of a hotbed for invasions, the last I checked, I didn't get one though. Ronin's Ring, very handy. Pretty sure that is the one that reduces the wear and tear on your weapons. Kind of sad that, you know, no invasion happened here, though. I really want to see if invaders can set off or be hurt by the flying bombs. Because I know the enemies ignore them, but they can still, you know, interact with them. So I would figure that the bombs would ignore them, but that I could maybe trip them in the middle of a fight and, have an explosion hit the invader from behind. Obviously, that doesn't work the other way around. Of course, it could just be that I'm doing this at an odd level. I don't actually know what the general level that people go to this place is. Mine is probably skewed either by doing this first of the second batch of levels, or because I had that 100,000 soul bonanza from playing through a bit in pure black tendency. It's also really easy to slip off the walkways here, and it's especially annoying because you'll just have to go all the way back. And there are countless nooks and crannies with all sorts of items, so you kind of want to explore it thoroughly on one hand, but on the other hand, it's a vastly unpleasant place. Now this over here, that's actually the way to go forward, but it tricks you a little by having that same glowy soul effect that the death pit in the very first stage has. Oh, and the pile of corpses in front of it doesn't help either. Anyways, we got a few more slugs to kill. And I bet I can get that thing to blow at least one of them up. There we go. The range on that's actually kind of odd. I was expecting it to hit this guy down at the bottom as well, but it did not. Oh well. Got a little corpse examining to do, and there should be one more item. Yep, here it is. Stone of Ephemeral Eyes to replace the one I used. That should be it. Hold on. Okay, there it is. Yeah, I'm good at ledges. Bad part about falling there is that you basically have to go all the way back to start. back to start again. I'm really kind of sick of slipping off ledges. Although, in that case, it's more that there's kind of a dog leg that's difficult to see because of the perspective. Alright. Here we are. Doesn't actually kill you, although you might think it would. And we're at the boss door. Just quick equipment check. Gotta get my kite shield. Alright. The interesting thing here is that the boss doesn't immediately attack, unlike most of the bosses in the game. Some of them start attacking before you even go in, like Phalanx did. This is the Old Hero. I really like the aesthetics of this boss. It reminds me a lot of kind of the style they used in Final Fantasy X for the Chambers of the Faith, and it seems to me that the Old Hero is very much the same. Literally, an old hero that instead of just dying was bound to this place to defend it from intruders, etc. I could be wrong, but that's just what I get from watching the opening cutscene to the fight. The trick with the old hero is that he's actually blind. He has no idea where I am unless I make noise, or if I hit him with stuff. See, the last few attacks and sounds came from there, so that's where he struck. He's also got a big-ass sword that kind of clips through pillars, so you're not entirely safe if you're just hiding. So what you want to do is move around. Hit him once, go somewhere else, and he'll always be one step behind you. I also have the Thieves' Ring, which helps me with concealment a bit, but since I'm not in soul form, my steps still make a sound, so if I get too close, he will hear me. God, I'm pretty confused right now, though. Oh, and the one thing you want to do is you don't want to show him where you are when he's got his arms up in the air screaming like a maniac. That will trigger another attack where he kind of just flies at you. Or flies in the direction of whatever hit him. That can be difficult if you're playing as a melee character. This is one of the reasons, well, another one of the reasons why magic is often considered to be easy mode, because so many of the bosses can be defeated just by, you know, messing with them from afar. Of course, the risk is it's easy to screw up and get killed anyways. Now, let's give Poison Cloud a try. You can't poison every boss, as far as I can tell. But some of them you can. You know, it looks like this guy's one of them. You can see he's got the poison powder. Since he's constantly being damaged from, you know, where he is right now, I don't know what effect that has on the AI. It probably drives him a bit batty. I think it'd be cool, though, if it was like, well, I'm getting damage from, you know, myself, so he swings his sword at himself. That would be a little too easy, wouldn't it? As usual, looks like the Soul Ray does more damage than Flame Toss, but not as economical. And also, even though he's poisoned, note that the damage doesn't show up on the meter below. The meter is very slightly decrementing every time he takes the poison damage, but he might not realize that it actually worked unless he saw the purple cloud around it. Well, there's an upgraded version of Poison Cloud that causes plague, and I don't think that works on bosses. Or most bosses, anyways. It's kind of weird how they doled out the resistances and vulnerabilities in this game. Because it's like, well, you know, poison's fine because it's not actually going to kill anything. And the if you were to get the entire time for poison and spend it with him poison, you know, it would barely take off a fifth of their health, pretty much. But toxic, no. That's just straight out. And that'll do it for the old hero. His soul is particularly important to have, and actually doing this level in general was particularly important, because it allows us to get miracles. Advanced miracles. And the one we get from this soul is easily the best.